Mariner Books and Harper Audio present A Wolf Called Romeo by Nick Jans. Performed by Fleet Cooper. In memory of Greg Brown, 1950 to 2013. A friend to all living things. For the animal shall not be measured by man. In a world older and more complete than ours, they move finished and complete, gifted with the extension of the senses we have lost or never attained, living by voices we shall never hear. They are not brethren. They are not underlings. They are other nations, caught with ourselves in the net of life and time. Henry Beston, The Outermost House. Prologue. Are you sure about this? My wife, Sherry, breathed. She glanced over her shoulder toward the comforting glow of our house on the lakeshore, then gazed ahead where a black wolf stood on the ice in the gathering twilight. Bundled against the southeast Alaska cold, we'd taken along just one of our three dogs, our female yellow lab, Dakota, who'd always been perfectly mannered and under voice control around wildlife, from bears to porcupines. Despite some of the understandable jitters, Sherry was so thrilled she was about to jump out of her skin. After all these years of trying and not seeing, there it was, her first wolf. Perfect, I thought, and easier than it ever should be. But as we walked farther out on the ice, things changed. The wolf, instead of watching from the tree line as he had several times with me, angled toward us at a trot. Then he broke into a bounding lope, snow flying beneath his paws, jaws agape. I drew Sherry toward me and reached for Dakota's collar. Vision sharpened. Synapses crackled. I'd seen my share of wolves over the years, some point-blank close, and hadn't quite shifted into panic mode. But anyone who claims he wouldn't get an adrenaline jolt from a running wolf coming straight in, no weapon and no place to run, and loved ones to defend, is either brain dead or lying. In a few heartbeats, the wolf had closed the distance to 40 yards. He stood stiff-legged, tail raised above his back, his unblinking stare fixed on us. A dominant posture. Less than reassuring. Then, with a moaning whimper, Dakota wrenched free of the two fingers I'd hooked through her collar and ran straight at the wolf. A tone of desperation sharpening her voice, Sherry called again and again, but there was no stopping that dog. The lab skidded to a stop several body lengths short of contact and stood tall, her own tail straight out. And as we watched, mouths open, the wolf lowered his to match. With the two so close, I had my first clear idea of just how large the wolf really was. Dakota, a stocky, traditional-style female lab, weighed in at a muscular 56 pounds. The black wolf towered over her, more than double her weight. Just his head and neck matched the size of her torso. 120 pounds, I figured. Maybe more. The wolf stepped stiff-legged toward Dakota, and she answered. If she heard our calls, she gave no sign. She was locked on and intent, but utterly silent. Not at all her normal, happy lab self. She seemed half-hypnotized. She and the wolf regarded each other as if each were glimpsing an almost forgotten face and trying to remember. This was one of those moments when time seems to hold its breath. I lifted my camera and snapped off a single frame. As if that tiny click had been a finger snap, the world began to move again. The wolf's stance altered, ears perked high and held narrow. He bounced forward a body length, bowed on his forelegs, and then leaned back and lifted a paw. Dakota sidled closer and circled, her tail still straight out. The eyes of each were locked on the other. With their noses a foot apart, I pressed the shutter once more. Again, the sound seemed to break a spell. Dakota heard Sherry's voice at last and loped back toward us, turning her back, at least for now, on whatever call of the wild she'd just heard. We watched for long minutes with Dakota softly whining at our sides, staring toward the dark, handsome stranger who stood staring our way and whining back, a high-pitched keening that filled the silence. Half stunned, Sherry and I murmured back and forth, wondering at what we'd seen and what it meant. But it was getting dark. Time to go. The wolf stood watching our retreat, his tail flagging, then raised his muzzle to the sky in a drawn-out howl as if crushed. At last, he trotted west and faded into the trees. As we walked toward home in the deepening winter evening, the first stars flickered against the curve of space. Behind us, the wolf's deep cries echoed off the glacier. With that first close meeting one evening in December 2003, a wild black wolf became part of our lives, not just as a fleeting shape in the dusk, but as a creature we and others would come to know over a span of years, just as he came to know us. We were neighbors, that much is certain. And though some will scoff, I say friends as well. This is a tale woven of light and darkness, hope and sorrow, fear and love, and perhaps a little magic. It's a story of our time on this shrinking world, one I need to tell, most of all to myself. Late at night, it fills the spaces between heartbeats, nudges me awake. By speaking, I hope not to be rid of it, nor even to understand, but just to set down all the facts, the musings, and unanswered questions as best I can. Years from now, at least I'll know that I did more than dream, and that once upon a time, there was a wolf we called Romeo. This is his story. 1. Wolf. December 2003. I was taking my usual afternoon ski on Mendenhall Lake on an early December day, right behind the house. Ahead, the blue bulk of the Mendenhall Glacier loomed, framed by a ragged sweep of snow-laden peaks. McGinnis, Stroller White, the Mendenhall Towers, Bullard and Thunder Mountain, glowing in blue winter light. My nearest company was a hiker nearly a mile away. Concentrating on my skiing form, I almost missed the line of tracks that intersected my trail. Even at a quick glance, there was something about them that made me skid to a halt and double back for another look. It couldn't be. It was. Prints that would cover my palm, larger and more diamond-shaped than a dog's. Front and rear paw prints, almost an exact match, all laid out in that flowing pattern I'd seen so many times in my 2 decades living in the Arctic wilderness, 1,000 miles to the north. I brushed my hand lightly across one track, crisply etched, yet feather soft, just a couple of hours old at most. A wolf. Right there, at the edge of the city limits of Juneau, the state capital. Of course, this was Alaska, but even in the Great Land, one of its last strongholds anywhere on the planet, Canis lupus, the gray wolf, is spread thinly across the country. According to the state's own estimates, between 7,000 and 12,000, averaging out to fewer than 1/50th of a wolf for each of Alaska's 500,000-plus square miles. Most Alaskans, even those living in ultra-remote villages, spend a lifetime without ever seeing one, or even catching the echo of a howl. Here in Juneau, third largest city in the state, with a population of over 30,000, outdoors people and biologists talk of a pack that ran the ridgelines from Berners Bay south across the Mendenhall Ice Field as far as the Taku Valley, an enormous sprawl of dense rainforest, sawtooth mountains, snowfields, and crevasse-riddled glaciers. My wife Sherry and I had heard faint howls now and then from the deck of the home we'd just built, perched on the edge of suburbia and the wild, and counted ourselves lucky. A fresh wolf trail down on the lake, the most popular winter playground for the entire city, was big news. I spent minutes studying the tracks, which meandered from near the West Glacier trailhead toward the maze of trails, beaver ponds, and brushy woods known as Dredge Lakes. The animal, besides showing enormous feet, even by wolf standards, displayed a clear, habitual drag of his left rear paw, which made a distinctive furrow. On my homeward loop, I kept my eyes open, half expecting the trail to have been an illusion. But it was still there. I followed the tracks into the tree line and found overlapping older prints leading to circular depressions where the animal had bedded down. He'd been hanging around at least since most recent snow, a few days before. Back at the house, I blurted the news to Sherry. Though she nodded, I knew she didn't quite believe me. Couldn't it have been a wandering dog? Or a coyote, like we'd seen before, out on the lake? She'd moved from Florida to Alaska 15 years earlier and traveled thousands of miles across the almost unimaginable vastness of the state, trying and hoping to spy a wolf, without ever having caught so much as a flicker of fur. Now we had fresh tracks right here, a half mile from our door, and a 20-minute drive from the governor's mansion. To tell the truth, I still didn't believe it myself, even when I returned for another look. 2 days later, I lounged in the hot tub on our back deck in a cloud of steam, working out the kink in a sore shoulder when I spotted a dark shape moving far out on the ice. Even at a distance, that straight-backed floating trot practically shouted wolf. I jumped out, toweled half dry, and threw on ski gear. 10 minutes later, our three dogs trotting at my heels, I double-poled out along the lake's west shore. I knew the dogs, constant companions, our own pack, would stay close, and I carried a leash for our youngest, just in case. I didn't hope to more than see the wolf as a distant mirage, and only if I were lucky. Just around the bend from what area regulars call the Big Rock, a 10-foot-tall glacier-deposited granite boulder jutting from the shallows at the head of a bay along the west shore, I met two rattled women with their dogs. They'd just been followed for a quarter mile, they said, by a huge black wolf. Staring and intent, it had edged into unnervingly close range behind them. 20 feet, they gestured, then finally moved off after they waved and shouted. Where? I asked. They pointed north up the lake and hurried back toward the parking lot, dogs close at their heels. I skied on, and 3/4 of a mile up the lake, against the trees, I spied what must have been the same animal, standing, staring back over his shoulder. Wolf! A wild-edged thrill swelled in my chest, strong as the time I'd met my first, more than 2 decades before. My two labs and blue healer clearly understood this was no stray husky. Even mild-mannered Gus, the black lab ex-seeing eye dog we'd recently adopted, raised his hackles and rumbled a growl. Dakota, our gorgeous, almost white female lab, whined. Chase, the yearling blue healer, who was bred to guard the herd against such creatures, raised a sharp, desperate alarm as the wolf trotted into the brush. Though the odds were slimming by the moment, I raced back to the house, gathered my camera pack and tripod, and shut the heartbroken dogs inside with noses pressed against glass. I panted back out to the creek mouth where the wolf had disappeared. There he stood, a dark shape along the snow-deep shore. He must have seen me coming, but instead of loping off as I'd expected, he slowed to a walk.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.